Hello everyone, my name is Bethany and this is my channel Bethany's Thoughts. Today what I have planned is to start going over my September wrap-up. So September's been kind of a rough month. I think since the last couple have readathons that I've been going really hard on, I just kind of wanted to take it easy this month anyway. And then I also kind of felt like I got kind of mood slump, mood reading vibe. The month's been kind of a little bit all over the place for me. I've literally haven't read very many physical books and have really just been reading a lot of ebooks and audios. Also because everything on Libby has come at the same time. So I've gotten a ton of stuff on Libby in the last few weeks. Some of them sooner than anticipated. So that's what I was kind of focusing on. As well as reading my physical copy of Midnight Sun, which has been interesting and an adventure. So yeah, so I'll start going over my reviews for some of the books I've read so far, and then I'll come back as usual and wrap up with whatever I finish before the end of the month. The first book I read for September was A Sweet Mess by J.C. Lee. This was an Asian contemporary romance. It was about Landon and Aubrey. It was a one-night stand, and the tension between the two of them was fire. It was really good. The one-night stand, without him realizing he's a food critic, Aubrey owns a bakery, without him realizing that it's her bakery, they have this amazing one-night stand, and then he writes a really bad review of her bakery. So to make it up to her, he goes to her, comes to her, and says, hey, I have a TV show that I'm producing, and maybe we can get you on the show to, like, resurrect your business, because after his review, her business tanks. It was really cute. I really enjoyed it, except it used my least favorite trope, and if anyone saw me on Twitter rant about it, then you know what it is, which I don't want to say because I know some people consider it a spoiler, so I'm not going to say what the trope was, but it was unexpected, and it kind of lowered the value of the book for me, and then the ending was, like, weirdly, really dramatic, and I felt like their conflict they had was kind of weak. It started really cute, and I know there's a famous Asian actor, I can't think of his name, I'll put it somewhere, where he is apparently going to be Landon, and I think that's going to be great, and I will still hella see it. So I only rated it 3 stars, because like I said, I think it just really went downhill for me with after the trope, but that's my own personal trope and trigger that I have an issue with, so I don't know if anyone else would have the same issue with it. But the Asian rep was really, really cute. The build-up to their romance was really, really cute. So there were still things I really liked about it. I read it as an audio. The next book I read was P.S. I Like You by Cassie West. I read this as an ebook. It was a YA contemporary romance. This was about Lily and her anonymous messenger who basically in chemistry class, she starts writing on her desk and then sending anonymous notes to this guy in another one of her chemistry classes earlier in the day, and she gets his message later in the day, and they exchange notes and start to develop feelings for each other. It's been a long time since I've had a book compel me enough to stay up super late, and I will admit, I started reading this until like 5 in the morning. It was just so cute. I really liked their chemistry. Get it. It read really sweet, but also a little angsty, and angstier than Cassie West stuff usually is, because Cassie West usually does pretty innocent, clean, romance, sweet, cute YA stuff, but I felt like this is a little bit angstier on the side of angsty. I'm not going to say who the anonymous messenger was, because it's somewhat of a spoiler who she ends up with, because you don't know through at least half of the book, so I'm not going to say who it was, but I really liked his character, and I think that I just really wish I had seen a little bit more of them together at the end, because for so much of it, they didn't, you know, they didn't know who each other were, or they pretended not to know who each other were. It was still so sweet. I rated it 4.5 stars. I really, really liked it and really enjoyed it. The next book I read was The Flat Share by Beth O'Leary. I read that as an audiobook. That was about Tiffy and Leon. So they are flatmates. They share a flat. For those who don't know, a flat is an apartment in UK. They share a flat for opposite times. So Leon works the night shift and Tiffy works the day shift. So she comes in at night and sleeps in the apartment, and then Leon comes in during the day and sleeps, and then he stays out all weekend while Tiffy has the apartment for the weekend. So this is the arrangement that they made. They actually even share the same bed, except they're just on opposite sides of each other. This was a UK contemporary romance. The narrators for this audiobook were so good. I felt like they embodied the characters extremely well, and I felt the characters' voices through them. That they made it extremely enjoyable. It was a slow burn because obviously they're flatmates. They don't even meet each other for the longest time, and they have the most hilarious meet cute, I will say. That one was probably one of my favorites that I read this month. I rated it 5 stars. I really enjoyed it. I really liked the development of their relationship. I really loved how they felt they were so different from each other, but just how they really grew attached to each other and learned about each other just by living in the same space, even though they had never met, because they start also swapping notes back and forth, like, you know, oh, here's my leftovers, you can have some or whatever. There's something really, really sweet about it that I came to really enjoy. There is a content warning because there's an emotional abuse from an ex, and it's mentioned several times. There's some PTSD mentions. And also some violence from the ex as well. So just something to be aware about if that's a trigger for you. At least I should say for how sweet and lighthearted it was a little bit more intense than I anticipated. But overall, I still really, really, really enjoyed this book. So all the stars for that one. The next book I read was Geekerella by Ashley Poston. I read that as an audiobook. This was about Darian and Elle. It was a nerdy retelling of Cinderella, a YA contemporary. It was cute. I still really enjoyed it. I still really liked the concept. And this is part of her Once Upon a Con series, where she like takes like nerdy themed con stuff, like conventions, and, you know, and has these like fairy tale retellings. It was cute. I still liked it. I rated 3 stars. And I don't know if it was the narrators that really killed this for me. If you have a really bad narrator, it just kills the book, right? So the narrators read it really overly dramatically. Elle's narrator was probably better. Elle's narrator was just like the emotional abuse that she experienced from her stepmom, which is pretty bad which was more severe than I expected in a way, contemporary, was just read really dramatically and emotionally. And I'm like, this isn't a drama. This is a YA contemporary romance. I don't know if I signed up for this. And then his narration was obnoxious. He like emphasized the wrong words in a really weird way. There was something about his cadence that really threw me off. And very William Shatner-esque. That's the only way I can describe it. Yeah, I really didn't like the narration. I think that really put me off from the book, unfortunately. Maybe if I try to reread it at a future date, maybe I'll feel differently. I also didn't really believe the chemistry between the two of them was really weak. And then the whole series is called Once Upon a Con, which as a fellow convention goer, I want like things happening at a convention. Like conventions are fun. I love going to nerd conventions. And she's literally at the convention for like 5 minutes and that's it. And that's all you see. And I felt like this is called Once Upon a Con and you literally have her at the con for 5 minutes. Nonsense. Not my favorite. I think the audio killed it for me. But I am low-key interested in some of the rest of the books. Maybe her writing gets a little bit better. Maybe I need to read it instead of listen to audio. I'm not really sure what I'm going to do with it, but yeah, I didn't really love it, unfortunately, which I was super bummed about because fairy tale nerdy retellings is pretty much my jam. So The Midnight Circus by Jane Yolen, I read that as an ebook ARC, from NetGalley. It was a collection of short stories and comes out October 1st. And I finally figured out, I think I had mentioned in my TBR that I wasn't sure what book I had read by Jane Yolen previously. And the book that I read previously that I remembered when I came across it at the bookstore, which was so funny because it's a book like from the 90s that happened to be randomly in this independent bookstore I went to. It's called Briar Rose. And it is a Briar Rose, which is also the name for Sleeping Beauty, which is a retelling set in World War II, I believe, during the Holocaust. And I think I remember really, really loving that book. I can't remember a lot of details about it. Definitely worth a reread. I'm going to have to see if a lot of my childhood books are my parents' house. I have to see if that one still exists and at my parents' and see if I can reread it. Because I was looking intrigued. So if you wanted to know what book I remembered reading from Jane Yolen, that's the one. This particular book, The Midnight Circus, was a collection of short stories. They were darker stories, fairy tale-esque short stories were based on, you know, calling herself the darker version of America's version of Hans Christian Andersen, which I could see. I mean, some of the stories, I enjoyed a lot of the stories that were in there. Some of the stories were a little odd or off-putting, but quite a few of them were, and a lot of them were dark. Quite a few of them, though, were very poetic. The writing was really beautiful. I still really enjoyed quite a few of them. The only thing is that several of them, because she's such a prolific writer and obviously a really talented writer, a lot of the stories were very different from each other. Some of them were sci-fi, some of them were set contemporary, some of them were set in past times or like a fantasy type pastime. Some of them were set in first person, some of them were set in third person. You know, they switched so much of the style, which I think obviously shows how talented Jane Yolen is, but it was very jarring to switch from story to story and have the style and the narration be so different from each other. And it was hard for me to see where the cohesion of the story collection really was. And also a lot of the short stories are taken from some of other Jane's other works, so that she's published before. There was a couple that were maybe new, but I think most of them were from other previous publications that she just kind of put together in one book, which is maybe why it was kind of seemed really disjointed. I still really enjoyed it. The writing is still really beautiful. If you like a short story collection, darker fairy tales type of style, definitely would recommend. The next book I read was Stocking Stuffers by Erin McClellan. This was an ebook. I just really wanted a cute, short, smutty read because that was what I was in the mood for. All the mood reading was happening this month. This was about Sasha and Perry. It's a holiday stranded novella. Very smutty. Sasha is there at a holiday lodge to sell to a group of a romance book club group. And Perry shows up. He's the brother of one of the members. She's at this holiday lodge. She gets stranded there for 2 or 3 days and she's selling sex toys. She's a sex toy saleswoman. And so she's selling sex toys to the romance book club while Perry walks in. And then a lot of smuttiness ensues and a lot of sex toys are used and it's a smutty good time. It was really cute though. Like, I felt like the evolution of the characters was actually really well done, considering it was like only 180 pages. It packed a lot in there and it was really cute and also very sex positive. Sasha's character, I believe, is bi. Her brother is gay, and he's actually one of the other books about his romance. So there was, yeah, it was super cute. It was such a good time. I had a ball. It was super cute. It's on Kindle Unlimited if you want to check it out. I rated it 4 stars. Yeah, it was adorable. And if you want a smutty novella, smutty good time, holiday themed, then definitely check it out. The next book I read was The Seven Husbands of Evelyn Hugo by Taylor Jenkins Reid. I read this in audio. This is the story of Evelyn that is like this Hollywood starlet. And Monique is a character that is interviewing her. And as Monique is interviewing her, Evelyn is telling her story. So one of the things I realized while listening to this book is I don't like stories told that way. I don't know why. It's just me thing. I don't like stories that are narrated to me in that way, through like a third person filter. I still really enjoyed it. I rated it 4 stars. I think that there was, I mean, I didn't really like Evelyn or Monique as characters. They're not lovable characters, but I didn't hate them. Like, I think that they were somewhere in between. I just didn't really find them very likable. But the story, like Evelyn's journey, is really, really beautiful. And then Monique learning from Evelyn's journey was really well done. And the LGBT representation was also beautiful as well. So I think there was a lot of elements of the story that I really enjoyed and I really liked. I wasn't wowed. I didn't absolutely love it. There was a lot that I really liked about it and I was intrigued and I was interested to see where it would go. But it just didn't make me love it. The next book I read was Sea Witch by Katie Robert. That was, I read as an ebook. This was the next book in the Wicked Villain series, which if you watched my channel before, you know this is one of my favorite series. It is so good. Give me all the smuttiness in Disney. Give it all to me. This was about Zuriel, Ursa, and Alaric, which is basically Ariel, Ursula, Eric, threesome, coming together, Zuriel goes and basically sells herself at a virgin auction. Ursa buys her, and Ursa and Alaric are already like a thing, and they bring Zuriel in. All this funniness, as Katie Robert usually does, she brings it. It was super good. I thought the character progression happened a little bit too quickly, because I feel like with these characters, they don't really know each other well as some of the other characters in the previous books did. So the progression kind of happened a little bit quick for me. And then the ending was really, really abrupt. So it wasn't my favorite of the series. I gave it 4 stars, though. It's still really, really good and still really delightful. Ursula being the black boss bitch was amazing. She was so great. She was definitely my favorite character from that group. And the next book is about the Sleeping Beauty somebody retelling, which is Aurora, and then the name for Maleficent is Malone. And I am here for it. I'm really, really excited about their story because they've been hinting at it throughout pretty much all the books. Aurora's been a character, so super excited for that one coming out next. But Sea Witch was just, it was just delightful. I think Beast has been my favorite so far, though. The next book I read was Work For It by Talia Hibbert. This I read as an ebook. It is a male-male romance. Actually, one of my first male-male romances. I haven't read a lot of male-male romances before. And I mean, I knew I could trust Talia Hibbert to do it right. And she did. She did. She did. She did. She did such a great job. This is about Griffin and Olumide? 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 But he goes by Olu. And the smutiness is fire. Just fire. That's what I read. I literally wrote fire. The buildup, the chemistry, the tension between the two of them, super hot. A little bit of a slow burn. It starts kind of slow. Olu is like this posh city guy who is raised from money, but and has some, you know, background trauma issues going on with his parents. And then Griffin is this gentle giant farmer who like has been lived in this small town his whole life and has been dealing with the death of his mother. Their connection was just really sweet and really genuine. I just think Talia Hibbert, her characters are done so well. I love her characters so much. They're so fully developed to me. And I think that's why I really, really enjoy her stories. And this was no exception. I rated it 4 stars. So the next book I read was One to Watch by Kate Stayman London. It was an audiobook. And I rated it 3 stars. So I'm going to try not to go on a rant about this one. I had a lot of feelings about this book. I should preface it to say that I am not a Bachelor or Bachelorette fan. I do not like those kind of shows. Not any against anyone who does. If that's your, it's a piece, I know the reality show is a piece of fluff. It's supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be drama. It's supposed to be like, you know, creating this atmosphere of, you know, rooting for a romance, which I read romance books, so I get it, but it's not one of my favorite TV shows. Here's the thing. I don't really like a lot of reality TV. I love competition reality shows. I love Project Runway. I love Top Chef. I love, like, give me all the Voice and all those, American Idol. Like, I love the competition stuff. But when it comes to reality shows of, like, either them just hanging out or reality shows where it's, like, obviously contrived and forced, I'm not a fan. I don't watch it. I will say, if you like the Bachelor and Bachelorette type shows, then this might be the book for you, because the drama was all there, you know, and I was invested in the story the whole time. So let me go into explaining what this book is about, because I'm going ahead of myself. B is a plus size fashion blogger. She is getting over a really devastating, not gonna even call it a breakup, she's getting over a really devastating heartbreak, and she decides to, she's asked by the producer to join the show to compete and be like, you know, represent the plus size demographic and representation. And she joins in really just trying to doing it to help her business and get more recognition for her business and bring her up in, you know, that regard, but not really expecting to find love or wanting to find love. And her journey is interesting. I am not a plus size person. I've been around several family members who have had weight issues in the past, and I just feel like a lot of the self-esteem issues that she has and not thinking that she's sexually attractive to men is just, was just exhausting. And then counter on the fact that she's grieving the heartbreak of this friend of hers who basically ends up sleeping with her and then completely ghosting her, and she's like devastated over it. I mean, completely devastated, like she's had a full-on 10-year relationship with him. And I just didn't really get it. I couldn't get into this insecurity that she had, and it just seemed whiny and morose and self-sabotages herself at every turn. And then all of like her previous dates, even before the show, she doesn't really have a lot of experience because she's been crushing this one guy friend of hers for 100 years. And I'm just like, where does she find these terrible guys to date? Like, she hasn't had any good positive relationships in romantic relationships in her life. It was just really, I just really struggled her explaining that. And then, I don't want to give too much away, but there's a lot of fat phobia. There's like interspersed in between the episodes, you get like blogs, blog posts, articles, podcast transcripts, which is, and then there's like this random Slack channel. I have no idea where the Slack channel, like the Slack channel was really weird. Anyway, the reason with all the problem with all those news posts and everything that they had in mixed, there was a lot of fat phobia and a lot of fat hate, and it was really, really gross to read a lot of those things. I mean, I think the writer was trying to emphasize how like it really is in reality out there, which is fine. I don't feel like I really needed to read it. I don't think I really needed to read it to get to understand that being a concept, especially because of some of the experiences that she has with the guys in the show who are also very fat phobic and gross. Yeah, did I really need the blog posts and the comments, like the Twitter comments or whatever, calling out, like calling B a fat cow? No, not really. I like the concept. I think the execution was not great. I think a lot of it worked on stereotypes. Like, obviously a plus size woman is going to feel herself not sexually attractive to men. No, absolutely not. That doesn't have to happen. That doesn't necessarily need to be the case. A woman can feel insecure in her own body, but also still find herself sexually attractive and sexually active. And, you know, I don't know. I just didn't really love it. I had some issues with it. Yes, but I was invested. I still, like, read the whole thing going, oh my god, what is going to happen? I need to know what happens next. And I think that maybe also made me hate it just a little bit more, because I was, like, way too more invested than I wanted it to be, considering all the problematic issues that I was having with it and how angry it was making me. Overall, still liked her character arc. But, like, at the end, her character arc happened so abruptly, I was like, I don't know if I necessarily believe it. And it didn't end how you expected, which I liked. And I think she still chose the right guy in the end, though, because he was my favorite. So, yeah, I don't know. I had some mixed opinions on that one. Solid 3-star. I still liked the concept. There were some things I still really liked about it, but so many problematic issues I had with it. The next book I read, I actually have. This is one of the very few physical ones that I've finished. It's Intercepted by Alexa Martin. I read it in 2 days before the New to Swoon book club. So this was about Marley and Gavin. This is a sports romance. I rated it 3.5 stars. This is Alexa Martin's first book, and it definitely reads like a first book. Not in a bad way, but just obviously her first work. I think it was still good. Marley is a NFL girlfriend, she's not an NFL wife, which is a point of contention in most of the book, to a guy who, and this is not a spoiler because it says on the back of the book, to a football player who she finds out is cheating on her. So she leaves, and then she starts dating another football player who she had a one-night stand with, is very strongly pursuing her, and how their whole relationship works out. Thought the build-up was really, really cute. I thought Marley was a really strong character. I think she has some really great boss bitch moments, telling off the other terrible women that were the NFL wives, which I 100% believe that those terrible women exist. They definitely exist. I went to an all-girls high school, and nothing against the girls I went to school with, but man, I saw some things. I saw some things. So they definitely, definitely exist. I was not surprised by these NFL wives being as atrocious as they are. I thought there was a lot of weak points, though. I think the conflict at the very end just kind of came out of nowhere. I think if it had been drawn out and built up more, I think it would have made a lot more sense. I mean, it made sense in the concept, but it also was kind of weak because it just kind of evolved out of nothing when it could have been drawn out through the whole novel as a point of contention and issue. Like, they had this really intense one-night stand, and she mentions it several times, but I didn't really know what you don't ever see the one night stand. You don't know what kind of connection they make in the one night stand and how it, and then they meet 4 years later in this book, like how that impacted their, you know, connection to each other. So I kind of, and I feel like it kind of didn't make me really believe their chemistry a whole heck of a lot because I didn't get that. And there was also, I also like there was interracial romance. Marley is biracial, Gavin is white, and Alexa Martin's a black writer herself. So I liked that. She's also an NFL wife, so she's knows what NFL wives do and go through. And so I think that was really interesting, and I enjoyed that aspect of it. Yeah, it was just there was parts of it that were a little weak for me that I didn't love, but I still think it was a solid first book to start off. And I bought the second one on ebook on Kindle. There was a Kindle sale, and I decided to just go ahead and get it. And it's from about one of the other football players that was mentioned. And I thought he was really cute. You only see him like a couple scenes. And I'm really excited for his book. And I've heard a lot of people really like Fumbled over Intercepted. So I'm really excited for that one at least. And that's it for books I have finished for now. So I'm going to end this. And then I will be back when to officially wrap up my wrap up. And I'm back. So the end of this month didn't go according to plan. I ended up, instead of trying to rush and trying to cram in the last two books that I was in the middle of, which I was not very close to finishing anyway, I decided to totally change my plans, table those for now, and I joined the Kindle Clear Out Readathon instead. And so I did finish a couple more books, but I'm counting them from October, so I'll include those in my October wrap-up. So right now, I don't have any more books that I read for September. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and wrap up and then mention the other two books that I'm still in the middle of that I have been reading this month. Total, I've read 11 books. The two others that I was in the middle of that I have not finished is The Starless Sea by Erin Morgenstern and Midnight Sun by Stephenie Meyer for reasons. In total, I read 5 audiobooks. I told you I read a lot of audios. 4 ebooks and 1 physical book. This month, I had 1 5-star, 6 4-stars, 4 3-stars, and nothing below that. So, still a decent reading month. I mean, that's still pretty good, not bad. And yeah, and that's it for my wrap-up. So there you have it, in the middle of 2 of those books that hopefully I'll be finishing for October, and I'll include those in my October wrap-up, and you can see them then, and my thoughts then. I'll also probably be doing a vlog of just Midnight Sun, whatever that may be. Thank you so much for watching. If you like what you saw and want to see more from me, please subscribe and likes and hit bells. And I'd really appreciate it. Comment, let me know if you read any of these and what your thoughts were, if you disagree with me. I know One to Watch was definitely a book that a lot of people have had very mixed reviews about. Be curious to know. Again, thanks for watching, and I'll see you again soon. Bye!